steps of my King. Hey everyone, welcome to this next episode. I think we'll call it Pastors Unplugged because of the topic, but you can listen to both of these, Pastors Unplugged or Idleman Unplugged, wherever the podcast is carried. But it's an important topic, and I wrote down a couple notes. Why are so many pastors or Christian leaders, or even Christians in general, why are they drifting? And I mean, even in my area of California, you go to different states, Tennessee, Georgia, even Texas, you know, well-known pastors or Christian leaders or worship leaders are starting to, the COVID crisis and I believe the LGBTQ agenda is really causing camps to divide. And Paul, I remember Paul saying, you know, that there must be division among you, 1 Corinthians, I believe, to prove those who are right before God and those who are not. So he said, I hear that there are divisions among you, and in part, I believe it, because there has to be fractions or divisions among you to show who is on God's side and who's not, because who's ever not on God's side and who is on God's side according to his word, those two camps are going to be divided. So, you know, what is going on? I can think of right now as I'm recording this, pastors who are not coming out on, you know, let's say they're not going to be clear on gay marriage or what the Bible says about homosexuality, or they're not talking about repentance or the blood of Christ or judgment or anything. It's almost like they're just trying to be a motivational speaker and gain lots of followers and different things. So here's what happens. And again, this is Idleman Unplugged. It's not necessarily teaching. I'm not going through the Bible, pulling up scriptures, although I do sometimes. But many of us know the scriptures too, where Jesus talked about some soil, some seed fell on good soil, some fell on, you know, other rocky soil or on the hard soil. But there are different soils. So a Christian leader, here's what happens. Let's say they were a Christian and they are a Christian. If you're not in God's word, obeying God's word with a broken, humble heart, seeking the heart of the Father, worshiping, praying, bringing in fasting and just humility and wanting the fullness of the Spirit, if you're not doing those things, then you're not going to be full of the Spirit. You'll be quenching and grieving the Spirit. And so what will happen as a result? You will begin to drift away from God. And that's what we're seeing. So these people are drifting away from the shore because they're not anchored to the rock. And all of us, including myself, will drift if we don't stay anchored to the rock of Jesus Christ. So that's happening. Also, what's happening is some seed falls on the soil where the thorns grow and things grow, and they actually choke out the work of the Spirit. They choke out doing anything because I love the riches. I love the money I make and the book deals and the followers and the likes, and I'm up on this pedestal as this Christian idol. Instead of American idol, we should call it Christian idol is what's happening. And so they're not going to stand for the difficult truths of God's word, because it's the difficult truths that draw that line of demarcation in the sand. And they're consumed by the cares of this world, reputation. And I do know, I can't say names and things, but there are, let's say, high-level pastors making good money. And they know if they start to get like Leonard Ravenhill and A.W. Tozer and, you know, modern-day prophetic voices, there's a good chance they're going to lose a significant amount of their givers, of their tithing. They've got Democrats in their audience, Republicans in their audience, Independents in their audience. And when you preach God's word, it's going to offend all three of those parties. That's why God is not Republican or Democrat or anything. He is not part of a party, but parties should line up with him, right? Of course. But so a lot of these pastors you're going to see are not wanting to lose that audience or a portion of the audience. I think they'd have the audience of God, and that would be ideal. And you'll see a lot of the churches that closed down or shut down for a long time during COVID, you know, they're struggling, where a lot of the churches like ours and others who stayed open and ministered to the people, they grew substantially financially and in numbers. And so God rewards those who are obedient. So that's one thing that's happening too. The cares of this life, they begin to choke, and they'll choke me too. They'll choke you or anybody else if we allow ourselves, again, back to the first point, to drift. And then the other soil, of course, is the tribulation, when they don't have enough root down. You know, if you ever see a seed grows right under the surface, it doesn't last long, because if the plant that is growing gets stepped on or just pulled, I mean, the roots have to go deep. Often the deeper the roots, the more secure the tree. And so a lot of these people, again, including myself, all of us, because they're not deeply rooted, and goes back to what I said at the beginning, time with God. Time. I mean, if you're spending time with God, that's why these old saints that came before us could stand before God and men and rightly declare God's truth. They could die a martyr's death. They would not capitulate. They could stand before Rome and say, here I stand, I can do no other. They can stand before the Queen of Scots, like John Knox, and renounce the sin. How could they do that? Because they spent time with God. They were men and women who spent time with God. They weren't on TikTok, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, going here, going there. Now we rate success by how busy we are. Man, I'm just so busy. I got this staff. I got this budget. I'm so busy. But you don't know the power of God. You've lost that intimate relationship with God. And so because there's no grounding, there's no real deep relationship with God, as soon as the trials spring up, again, that's why I say COVID revealed a lot. It showed you what was really going on in the heart of the Christian leaders across our country. And then when the tribulation comes, or the persecution, and that's one thing. I mean, I remember I came back to the Lord late 1990s, 99, but in the 1980s, you know, or even 1990s, the LGBTQ, we just want affirmation. We want to know that, you know, people love us and we're accepted. And okay. And then the next thing and now we want this. Now we want marriage, definition of marriage. And now it's, you know, teaching ungodly curriculum in the schools. And now it's men can dress up like provocative women and seduce children. You can go in locker rooms. See, it's a slippery slope, and wickedness just keeps prevailing and prevailing and prevailing. And when that persecution or that tribulation is coming against you, if you're not deeply rooted in God's word, then you will back away, because you don't want to offend men, but in doing so, you're offending God. And so that's why you don't want to stand for the truth or preach the truth, because it's going to bring possibly some more tribulation. It's going to bring some more conflict. And that's Joel, you know, sound alarm, call sacred assembly. But that's the job of the pastor. Maybe you might want to relook what you signed up for. You signed up for the pastoral duties, and that is to preach the totality of God's word. So when people, you know, like myself, other people, you know, when we talk about, let me just throw some names out there right now. And, you know, when we talk about like a Joel Osteen or a Steve Infernick, or even where T.D. Jakes has gone, drifted. I mean, I haven't listened a long time, but back in the 1990s, you know, he was preaching some hot stuff, good stuff. And then Andy Stanley, just right this week in the news, I just did a podcast on this. Think of some bigger names. I mean, maybe in my area, Judah. I don't remember his last name, Judah Smith, possibly. And of course, before Carl Lentz fell, and Brian Houston. And I mean, you can look. It's not very difficult. Those who are standing up for truth, and those who are not, because they don't want to offend their audience. And I can go just down the list, of course. And you see the name. You know, solid teachers, and you know those who aren't solid. And that's what's happening. Any of us, again, I'm saying this humbly. I haven't mastered it. I can drift just like everyone else. How will I drift if I don't stay anchored to the rock? He who hears my saying and does them, I will liken him to a man who built his house on the rock and it did not fall. I've got a few other points I want to share briefly on what could be going on to help you. Or they could not be saved, right? We know that. Not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, is saved. So they could be, and I know in my area, again, definitely not naming names, but I have some questions on some of these leaders. I don't even know if they know the Lord. I think they're struggling through it. That's why they capitulate. That's why they get all worked up about the government. That's why they support ungodly legislation and leaders, because they're not genuinely saved. And they need They need the fire of God in their lives. And again, it goes back to teaching the whole Word of God. Just this morning, I read where Jehoshaphat, King Jehoshaphat, went and had the Word of God taught throughout all the land. And the Bible says that they feared the Lord as a result of that. And then I also read Micaiah. Is the same chapter there, Jehoshaphat. Micaiah, the prophet, they told him, hey, just tell the king what he wants to hear. Not Jehoshaphat, I believe, is Ahab. Jehoshaphat was lining up with Ahab, and God even called him on that, said, don't line up with Ahab. Why are you aligning with evil? That's another lesson right there. And so the prophet said, I'm going to say whatever God tells me to say. I can't cater. I can't capitulate. So you have a lot right there of what is going on. That's what's going on. Like, I can't believe this. I can't believe this. Now, I don't say I can't believe this. I just say that's really sad. Worship leaders. And the big word right now is deconstructionism. And they take pride in deconstructing their faith. And what they're actually doing is they're leading people astray. And it's better for them to not even been born than to have a millstone hung around their neck and cast into the sea than to lead these little ones, these young adults astray. And that's what I deconstructed my faith. I had a faith, you know, early on, and I left it. Here's why. I would submit to you that they probably didn't. What happened is they're raised in a good home. Maybe not a good home necessarily, but they're exposed to the Bible. This is what good people do. I'm an American. I go to church. That's what good people do. Hey, I want to be a pastor because I like people. I want to help people. I want to do worship songs because I'm gifted. God gave me this ability, and I like worship. I like being on the stage. I like helping people. And you can see when it gets tough, when the rubber meets the road, it's solid faith, perseverance. Genuine saints will persevere, teaching of Calvinism, perseverance of the saints. You don't have to embrace Calvinism to believe that. You just have to say, you know, it's pretty clear that the Bible teaches that those will persevere to the end who truly know God, and those who fall away often don't know God. And that's a whole nother podcast. And can I lose my salvation? Am I saved, secured, guaranteed with the Holy Spirit? I have another podcast on that you can find. I'm also putting my book, If My People, read this or listen to this in case of national emergency. By the time you listen to this, I don't know, we're going to be releasing that book soon. So keep an eye on that on Audible and Amazon and different places. It's called If My People, Read This in Case of National Emergency. But anyway, the drift, a lot of those people, because when you have saving faith, when you've bowed your knee to Jesus Christ, you're filled with the Spirit of God, you're spending time in His Word, you're not going to drift. You can't. That's God keeps you. Christ holds you. But when you choose to, you know, get a little arrogant, walk away. I don't really believe the Old Testament anymore. I think we need to unhitch ourselves from the Old Testament. And you start making dangerous statements, and you start, you know, just questioning things and Paul's writings, and now you actually have more passion for people blatantly in sin, shaking their fist at God than you do for God's people. You should have both. I mean, you have compassion for the sinner, but you also love the saint. And so a lot of these mega church pastors or even small churches, I know there's a lot of small churches not doing well, who don't like what I'm saying right now. They prefer the soft, tell me gentle things, tell me nice things. They don't like the hard truths of God's word. It has to make you really wonder, where's their heart at? And it's not in a good spot. So we have to pray for them. And if you happen to stumble on this and that's you, I just want to encourage you, just repent and say, God, I've drifted. I've been lost without you. I've mocked your word. I've questioned your word. I'm avoiding the hard truths of the Bible because I don't want to offend anybody. And God, I may have offended you. I need to repent to that. God, would you please fill me again with your Spirit? I want the joy of the Lord. I want that joy I had when I first knew you. I want to return to my first love. Or you can say I've become critical and bitter and angry and a judgmental spirit. And some watching this, they'll see the title of this and go, yeah, go get him, Shane. Well, I'm going to get you too, because a judgmental Jerry or a critical Kathy is not going to get very far in these dire times as well. If you're prideful and arrogant, throwing the word at people, using it as a robber would use a knife, but not as a surgeon who would use a knife to heal. You know, you're hurting people, you're judgmental, you're condescending, you have no love. You can pick apart things, pick apart this podcast, pick apart the word of God. I mean, what translation a person uses, pick apart this church, you're a pick aparter and you're a sin sniffer. You need to come to deep, deep repentance and humility as well, because God will not work through a prideful vessel. He resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So they might be drifting. This podcast is towards those who are drifting away from God by everything I just talked about, but you're drifting from God because of your pride and your arrogance, your selfishness, your judgmentalism, your self-righteousness, and looking down on others and not having compassion, concern, not having love. Man, you need to repent as well. So I'm hoping this sparks some type of mini revival in the hearts of those watching. And I'll pick up another topic here next week. And so you can email us at shaneidleman.com if you have a topic in mind. Again, shaneidleman.com. One of our administrators will get those emails to me, and hopefully I can cover it in the next episode of either Idleman Unplugged or Pastors Unplugged. This one is for laity and just the common Christian. This one is for pastors and those in pastoral leadership and Christian leaders. And even if you're following this, you can listen to this as well. They're both for the body at large. Thank you.